Kia ora tātou, everyone. Welcome. And we'll get underway again to hopefully complete this annual plan meeting by 9:30, with any luck. We'll kick off with a welcome to Mr. Weatherall from the Saddle Hill Community Board. Welcome, Scott. You've got us bright and early and fresh this morning, so welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Welcome the council, and thanks for the invite to come along. Our apologies for yesterday. Our board had a bit of a drive around the area, and it was really, really good actually, leading into the year with three new community board members. So we're all singing off the same song sheet, which is always good. I know you work at the same at this table. So. Firstly, I'd just like to thank the councillors who aren't here, the ones that were here last year and haven't re-stood. So thanks to them, the ones that have returned, and also a welcome to the new ones. It's a pretty exciting time for you guys, and I'm sure you'll listen to the community advocates and the advisors, and you'll factor that into any planning going forward. Also to the staff, you know, we work really closely with the staff, and for the majority, a really, really positive relationship. And that's something that we've always tried to pride ourselves on for our community board, and that's something we'll continue to do. Our board have made a submission with our priorities in specific order. So road safety has to be our number one, and a wee bit disappointing, because these two priorities were our number one priority last year. But acknowledging that the transportation team have been doing some work on moving these things forward. We also acknowledge that there's considerable money that would have to be invested into both of these projects to make any significant improvements. So the first one, I guess, is officially known as the commercial corner at Green Island there. It just needs some assistance with some traffic flow. But I understand the staff are finalising some potential sort of options to move forward on that. But what I would ask the council is to do is to consider that option from the staff and invest in that, please. I think the option that they're potentially coming up with is around a roundabout option. So what the concern is, there's two concerns. One is the delay in the flow at coming on back onto Brighton Road. The other one is that the traffic actually backs up on Westland Street back into the motorway. So that's of considerable concern. The other one is the Allington-Scroggs-Hill Road-Scroggs-Hill Road intersection. And that's a Google Map picture there I've showed you. Since this picture was done, staff have put some cornering signs up. Unfortunately, those have been knocked down several times, and just last week again knocked down. The concern is where you can see the car just to the left of that is quite a considerable drop off the bank. So cars go through that fence. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I guess, is that nobody considerably gets hurt. So therefore, it's not well measured on any crash data. But rest assured, somebody goes through that fence several times every year. It is just a tragedy waiting to happen, though. The rural road extensions, again, for the new councillors, you won't necessarily know some of the history there, but the older ones will. We've been asking for reconsideration for the rural road extensions to be, ceiling extensions to be added back into your budgets moving forward. There's an absolute need for some of those higher volume roads to be sealed. If that's not going to happen, then can I plead this council that we work really strongly with the staff and the contract to absolutely maintain them to the level of the contract, because that's not been happening. And we are working with senior staff and the transportation team who appreciate, I think, our concerns on that. This road here in the pictures, McMaster Road, there's not too much gravel on that. And I visited yesterday with our board, and it's in much of the same state, although it was graded just before Christmas with some dust suppression that followed. So, and the reasons why we think that the two priorities for us, McMaster and Chain Hills Road, are listed there. I won't go through them, but There's an absolute need for those to be considered because of any emergency evacuations and things like that. We've seen the flood in 2015, we've seen the tsunami late last year, which both those roads were used considerably. The footpath extension, for us, we've got to work with staff and have a community meeting for the road that's in the picture, which is Brighton Road from the school heading south to the end of the residential area. But something that we have been asking for a wee while, since actually just before the tragedy on Blackhead Road, was some footpath provision from the top of Stevenson's Road to Tunnel Beach Road. And firstly, I'd have to acknowledge that's not within our board area, but we see a need and we kind of feel that we're, actually Councillor Wiley was advocating for that as well. And you may know a wee bit more about that, Councillor, but there was some commitment that that would be done in 16-17, and I just hope that doesn't get slipped off the radar. Coastal erosion, we know there's a significant problem at Ocean Beach, but you know the southern coast is not exempt of this as well. We know and appreciate the support that the council have submitted, the $75,000 towards the citywide project on this, but the sites, I could take you today to four sites along the southern scenic route from on Torrey Beach Road that I think are, and no other role other than I guess a concerned resident, that I think they are potentially putting some risk to the transportation network. Again, I had the privilege to take Mr. Saunders and show him, I guess, my concerns late last year, and he's aware of those, but I guess we're just asking again on behalf of staff, and also ask that there needs to be some provision to at least stabilise these to avoid further deterioration. And the cycleways, we've snuck into the background. We've watched and observed some of the challenges that the council have had in regards to cycleways. But enough's enough. You know, we've kind of not pushed our barrow, but we want to be pushing our barrow now. We think that some of the areas that we see cyclists is of higher volume than some of the other areas that have been focused on. The southern scenic route again. We've kind of sat on our hands and listen to the mayor in terms of some commitment from the national government in regards to a national cycleway policy, or you know. But if that's not coming, then we need to be doing something towards a provision of cycleway along the southern scenic route, because it is high use by recreational cyclists, competitive cyclists, but also the family riders as well. And there's some areas there that we really, really do need to put some commitment to. The other one is, I guess, joining the city with Mosgiel. And we know that there's some discussions around a tunnel, whether that's going to happen or not, I don't know. That's not for me to decide. But the Morris Road is the link road between Mosgiel and the city via Fairfield. So we would ask that there's some provision to put a formulated cycleway on that road. Our previous conversations with staff who have changed over the years, and this is not new, this has sort of been 5-6 years in the making in terms of our conversations, we just haven't been pushing it, is that the sticking point is the bridge that goes over the motorway, which is land transport. So if that's the sticking point, I would propose that we form a working party to have some conversations, to start discussions about how we can get around that, whether that's, I don't know, a scaffolding area that we can ride bikes on, I don't know. Specialist engineers will give some advice on that, but we absolutely need to make some commitment to the community and to the public that we would be working towards that. You know, as a city, we want people to be active, we want people to be riding and walking and stuff, and that's good, but we've got to put the infrastructure in place to support that. And our sixth priority for us is our public toilet at Fairplay Street. There's only one public toilet in Fairfield, which is on the southern side of the community at Walton Park. That, until recently, was closed Monday to Friday. It was open on the weekends when there was sports there. Other than that, it wasn't. There's been a huge amount of investment by this council, and thank you for that, by the investment by the community to upgrade and to do some really, really cool stuff at Walton Park. And if you haven't visited it, I'd encourage you to do so, and I'm happy to meet you out there and show you around. The cool stuff that has happened there with tracks, pump track, and some fantastic murals the staff have really led. But we need a toilet at Fairplay, which is a fantastic We reserve fantastic playground and a really cool area for young youth to be riding their skateboards and scooters and bits and pieces, but we need a toilet there, and I'd encourage us to factor that into any discussions around a toilet, a public toilet program, which I think has been discussed for the last couple of years. We just haven't quite seen the result of that. Just before concluding, any discussion around rubbish fees absolutely leads to a direct result of illegal dumping of rubbish in our community and lots of other communities, I know that. Forestry, lay-bys, bits and pieces, again, I could show you today. I could show you where some illegal rubbish has been dumped, you know. So there is a direct correlation. Any increase of rubbish fees sees an increase in illegal dumping. I don't have statistics, but I can absolutely show you where I refer to. And just an open invitation to the Brighton Gala Day this Sunday, 10 to 5. We'll have 10 to 12,000 people there. It's always a fantastic day, and we absolutely appreciate the support that we get from staff and through the funding, the community grants and events, so thank you for that. I just wish this council all the best for the next 3 years, but more predominantly this year.
Thank you, Scott. You're happy to take questions?
Absolutely.
Right. Councillors, any questions? I have one actually for a start. Going right back to the first priority, the Scroggs Roads. Hill road, you said the sign had been knocked down several times. Is that deliberate?
No. Just as an attempt to try and arrow to indicate to corner, but cars aren't cornering, they're knocking into it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, right. They're crashing into it. Yeah.
Right. Councillor Elder.
I'm excited about tourism and the Southern Scenic Route, and I support you on those ideas. Can you tell me a little bit about how the traffic's increased along there, and just some anecdotal stuff, the Freedom Camping and how that's going?
Yeah, sure. Well, Freedom Camping has obviously increased. Any marketing around the Southern Scenic Route, you know, we want to be in a part of, and we want to encourage people to use our area. Absolutely, we do. The Freedom Camping is quite interesting. There's a designated spot at Ocean View, which we see 25 to 30 campers every night. And we've seen it down to sort of 10 over the, 6 to 10 over the winter, so it didn't go away. You know, like we didn't have nobody, they continue to camp. I don't think the number of Freedom Campers has significantly increased. Because what we've seen was about 20 to 25 campers between Kaikoura Estuary and Torrymouth every night anyway, and all the lay-bys. What it's done is just condensed them into one spot, which has got a toilet, so that's really good.
Yeah.
I guess the development of any lay-bys we would be encouraging, because any of the self-contained campers can continue to use those spots.
Have you seen an increase in cycle tourism?
Occasionally you see them. There's some big hills, you know, especially when you're heading over towards Torrymouth, and potentially that might put some cycle tourists off. But yeah, definitely the recreational cyclists is increasing.
Yes, and it's quite narrow, that road.
Yeah, it is.
But it'll be lovely to cycle, I know. I bike from Picton to Queenstown once along the west coast on a 10 speed.
Right.
You know, when you're young and fit, hills aren't a problem.
Yeah.
I might not do it now.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just, yeah, I can see the point about the narrowness there.
Absolutely. And what we've got is we've got a huge drop off, you know, in that picture that I showed you. That's, I've got another picture at home there where I put my bike between the drop off and the white line, and there's less than a bike width. So, you know, what's that? There's a drop off there from the white line. And there's one yesterday that I showed our council. Our community board, sorry, at Dixon's Road, where we've got it's the safety barrier, and actually the safety barrier is hanging in mid-air. And again, unfortunately, I had some photos that I was going to bring today. Councillor Wiley has got them, maybe. It's on our Facebook page, is that what you're referring to? Yep. Sorry, okay. I got off the point.
Councillor Lord.
Yeah, look, Scott, actually, I want to get back to the first day as well. I often get bring up by people that claim to have driven down the paddock here and one guy rang me recently. Use your mic.
The top of Scroggs Hill there. Whereabouts is it that everyone actually goes? And I went along and the fences look that stuffed up. I couldn't.
So they go straight ahead over the
Oh, so they're going, if you came up from Ellington, they're going straight ahead that way?
No, so they, so this is obviously Law Roads here, so you travel up and then vehicles aren't. So what happens is most local residents drift into the middle of the road and they corner in the middle of the road. But if you don't know the road, then you kind of miss the corner and you go over. Yeah. So if you have a look at that, the fence post and the fencing on that corner, you'll see that the farmer, Ross McCleary, has replaced it multiple times.
Yeah. The problem is it's hard to tell compared with any of the other bits. It all looks sort of pretty similar.
I'm happy to show you, Councillor Little.
Yep.
Cool.
The question I have is, you know, one problem that we often find in areas is when the crashes are not recorded. And I wondered if you had any mechanism for collecting the anecdotal crashes where, you know, they're not reported officially, because that is quite helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. So I just sent a photo last night into Mr. Saunders and just identified the signs that have been knocked down recently with some pretty clear marks that led to it. I could, again, be more than happy to bring the farmer, Ross McCleary, in to talk to council. We can meet out on site and he would absolutely tell you how many people have been there.
So you obviously do have a mechanism for...
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Unfortunately, fortunately, nobody gets injured or significantly injured to date. So.
Thanks, Scott.
His claim is that he's pulled one person out of that gully once every 2 months for the last 20 years.
On average.
So, Scott, what is it that needs to be done to prevent it, other than teaching people to drive a bit better?
Yeah, so, I think there's some assessment being done at the moment, and there's some marks along either side of the road, so some data collection maybe, I'm not sure. So whether it's just as simple as putting a guardrail up, I'm not sure. Or again, if I go back to Mr. McCleary's reference, he thinks that the road actually needs excavated and redesigned. Yeah, and he's offered some of his paddock to assist with that if we needed to make it less of a journey.
Right, okay. Councillor Steadman. Thanks, Scott, for coming along. The cycleway thing, fair to say, you know, Freedom Campers, you've got camper vans and all that going down through there. Families of cyclists concern me with having a little track like that. It's very much a safety thing, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's no cycleway at the moment.
Yeah, so you've got a family trying to go down there, family of four, kid just, and you've got a tourist that is not actually thinking, might be tired or whatever, and, you know, it's a what-if situation, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And we don't want to wait.
No.
Further questions? Councillor O'Malley.
I'm wondering, actually, when in terms of that intersection, if Deborah Palmer should be involved with the road safety people in the council, rather than just, I'm sure that maybe who they're talking to, but make sure it gets to the right person in terms of that. Your concerns about increasing the seal and other such things, those are fairly large infrastructure spends, and of course that is going to require that if we bring that back onto the table, we're going to have a rates increase probably. So what's the toleration of a rates increase to bring back some of that functionality of the council that's missing right now?
That's a good question. It's not something I've asked our constituents, so I wouldn't feel comfortable when saying, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Scott, I guess the big one in the room would be Saddle Hill. Are you comfortable? It's a tough one to talk about, but what's your thoughts on it at the moment and where it stands?
Yeah, thanks, Councillor Wally. I guess to date, you know, we're extremely appreciative of what the staff have done and, you know, have regular communication with Dr. Bitterose around that. And we know that there's been significant investment into the legal costs, and it's just to identify whether there's consent or not. And we're back in the appeal court, I think, or appeal phase. So, hey, we're standing by, we're supportive of what the council have done and willing to support them in any way we can. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, knowing that road by Ross McCleary's, I've worked there for years on that property. It would just about be as simple as an overlay and shape correction for about a 50 metre length of it on half of the road, not a big exercise. Would that take the problem away? Change the camber, like Ross said, bring it back to the...
Yeah, and I think he's concerned that there's some lime underneath which kind of challenges the gradient of it. I mean, I'm not an engineer.
Yeah.
I just want people to stop crashing.
Yeah, all the ground out there, a teaspoon of water, and it just turns to slurry and runs away.
Yeah, yep. Sure.
But a shape correction on top of that over a short distance should cure the problem.
Sure.
So we are doing a design survey on that intersection at the moment, so plans are underway.
Cool. So I guess just to follow on, and I understand there has been some work, but there will have to be some investment with that. So I guess that's why I'm asking the council, making you aware.
Yep, we're aware of that as well. So cool. We don't do a design survey if we don't plan to fix the thing. So.
Cool. Thanks.
Any questions?
Very good.
Thank you.
It's not for Scott. It's a question for the community. Boards, I have been asked to come along to talk to us, which is absolutely fabulous, and I have to say that they've spoken very articulately and about their passions, but also some support of the staff, which I think we should note, which is fantastic, and it's not always been like that. The other part of that is that it's fine to come along and say what they need, but we actually don't. I'm not sure about the reporting mechanisms back of what they've asked for. And I think there's probably frustration that the community boards may have had in the past. And I'm just wondering what that mechanism is, especially as we're going out for a slightly different consultation process.
Because so if I might, Ruth and I had a discussion about this morning because a large number of the issues raised by the boards are in the infrastructure area. And so she's going to pull together a chunk of information for councillors in the first instance to show what's actually being delivered in the board areas. And then we were discussing what the best mechanism is for then feeding that back to both the community boards, although there's a range of meetings scheduled for each board in the first round, I think, with Ruth's teams. But one of the things is we thought we might pull the board chairs back together with the councillors once we have that information to make sure that there's just a complete picture of what's going on.
Outstanding, thank you. That's good, because it is really hard to report back, and I do think that they've given up time to be here, that we should ensure that the loop is... Thank you very, very much.
Now, what I propose to do, there's one or two matters that we need to resolve. So there's Councillor Wilson's resolution that you were preparing yesterday. Then I'm going to ask if there are any other matters which people want to raise, because one or two councillors have mentioned that there's a couple of things that they felt were omitted and they want to go back to. And then we need to resolve the issue that was laid on the table around engagement for the May meeting, and then there's the final resolution. So any other matters item will allow anything to be brought up that needs to be at that point. So can I come back now to Councillor Wilson?
Your Worship, without I'm just wondering whether we can ask some questions generically, because there are some things that I'm not even sure that I want to move submissions about. For example, one that hasn't come up is the potential transfer of buses and where that's going to be lying as far as LTP consultation and having that information available. So if we could ask the questions generically that we don't think are covered, then we may be able to...
That's fine, but yeah. I understood had a specific resolution
I've put in three or four potential resolutions about a number of things that have been touched on. And I also want to ask about buses, and there was one other that I will work out what it was before I have to.
Right, well, let's work through them one at a time.
Okay.
So do you want to fire the first one up? We just need to...
Oh, okay, you want to do them individually, okay.
We just want to get... There's a number of things, and we'll...
Okay, the first one is one that Pam did put up yesterday, City Forests, and that was just a governance or either one, whichever one you want to put up first. Oh, it's organic waste. So, yeah, that's fine. That staff and the community engagement leading up to the LTP explore the community desire for enhanced resource recovery and waste minimisation, especially as it relates to organic waste. And that's just ensuring that we know that people have a good engagement.
Is there a second to Councillor O'Malley? Okay. Thanks for
No, I think I've done enough on that.
So, on
the board,
all those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? Carried.
Okay.
The next one, I think...
Oh, I don't want to stop the momentum. But seeing as we're in the freestyle portion of the meeting, I thought I would seek some guidance as to when we were getting reports from staff around issues of... investor save options and the ongoing resourcing of the Cozy Homes Trust work.
There's no reports planned, but Sandy can give you a verbal update on those two things.
Wow, I can't hear that, sorry.
There's no reports planned. Whoops, there's no reports planned. But council, but Sandy can give you a verbal update now.
Can we come back to that?
I don't mind when, as long as it doesn't get lost in this. Yeah.
I think the next one is about City Forest. Pam, sorry. I forgot to take my computer home last night to see what I'd sent. I'm holding a dog. Now the question here, and I'm happy to take the lead from the council, but this is relating purely to the liabilities as far as carbon units go, but there is potential that this should be extended to all CCOs as far as not about land ownership but about their carbon management plan. But I just wanted to deal with this issue discreetly in the first instance. But I'm happy to take advice from the CEO if she thinks it should be expanded to have the carbon management plan also extend to the CCOs or have that discussion with them.
I think when we bring the carbon management plan back to you, that's probably a good time for you to discuss whether or not you want to include that this would apply to the CCOs as well.
Okay, so this is distinct. It's that staff report back in time for the drafting of the next statement of expectations with DCHL. Sorry, the next one, I think, is we're talking about February next year.
Are we talking about 2018? Are you talking about
Sorry, letter of expectation, sorry. Okay, sorry. Sorry, I'll get my timing correct.
But the statements of intent are supposed to give effect to our letter of expectation, so we signal what we want in our letter of expectation, so this is correct.
Letter of expectation with DCHL about DCC arrangements with City Forests Limited on DCC land and ETS implications. No, well, a letter of expectation is December 2017, isn't it?
So, Councillor Wilson, just to be clear about what the word implications means, as I understand it, you referred yesterday to whose liability it is, whether it's the land owner or the forest owner.
Mm.
That's the point, isn't it?
Yes, and the arrangements we have with City Forests, which I'm not aware of.
So this is about... I'm just trying to be clear about what the issue is. It's about whether this council, because it owns the land in some cases, might have the liability rather than the forest owner.
Yeah, and the implications of that.
Yep.
Thank you.
Councillor O'Malley.
Just to clarify along that point too, I mean, if the price of wood changes, you may not get replanting after harvesting, which then incurs the ETS charges. So maybe we'd want to have inside that City Forests plan around changes in the value of wood.
So I take it, Councillor Hawkins, you seconded this? Yeah. Are there any other speakers? Councillor Newell.
Just for my own clarification, how much direction can we give them in regard to if the price per tonne is increasing incrementally over the next 3 years? I mean, obviously they've got harvesting times, which is, you know, a good window to harvest their trees after that. and that is dependent on the prices, obviously, of the trees as well. So how much direction can we give them, and should we be directing them to go earlier while the price of carbon is lower, or?
This is just understanding more where we I'm not intending to direct them necessarily unless we hear and learn through this process that we've got a huge liability that we currently aren't aware of, which may or may not happen. So it's very much let's get the information on the table so we know what we can do rather than second guessing any of that.
Okay, thank you.
So I just had a quick chat to Gavin. The processes that the leader's expectation be done at the moment, we won't put it in this current one we're doing now because there's quite a chunk of work to do in order to do that. So we will tell them we want them to start work on this so that for next year's letter of expectation, so in about a year, this will form part of the work will have been done so that it can be clearly addressed.
Councillor Hall.
The understanding that I can come to is that the liability lands on the landowner, not on the forest owner.
Right. So, okay, are there other speakers? I'm supportive of this because we need to be clear about whose liability, you know, and when it occurs. But also going back to the question of Councillor Newell, I don't think we should be even considering going down the road of directing the company as to when they might harvest, etc. It totally overrides their responsibility to run the company in the best way they can. We just need to know, in my view, what liabilities might be coming up under certain circumstances and be able to, along in partnership with City Forests, plan for that so the best outcomes for everybody. Councillor Hall.
The plan of City Forests is they actually farm it. They cut X number of hectares per annum, and it's an ongoing rotation, so they cut, they plant. Under the ETS, you can retire 5 hectares of forestry per annum back into pasture or into something else. Anything over and above that, you have to actually pay for.
Right. All right, are there no further speakers? You want to exercise your right of reply, Councillor Wilson? Blank. I'm going to put it. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Any abstentions? It's carried. Right. Councillor Wilson, do you have any more?
I've got one about the film permit. I was just wondering if we could have a verbal report in May about the costs and benefits of having actually that zero feed. Because from what we heard yesterday, it's a discretionary fee anyway, or how it's applied. But I think that was offered to us, and I just would be interested in exploring it. I asked the question yesterday. I think Pam's got my.
Oh, I see.
Yep. Well, I just think if we actually put it on here, then it's because we've confirmed the fee in the other resolutions. I just want to explore that idea, and I'd rather have it tracked.
Could we just say in the resolution, if the council is so minded, that it covers the advantages and disadvantages?
That's fine. That's much better wording. Yes.
Yeah.
Rather than costs and benefits, the advantages. Yes, advantages and disadvantages.
So. Are you suggesting that costs and benefits be taken out and advantages and disadvantages be? Yeah, that's fine. So do you get that, Pam? Is there a seconder for this, please? Councillor Hawkins? Right. Councillor Wilson, do you wish to speak to this further?
No.
Right. Okay. Are there any other speakers? Councillor Vanders.
Given that the $500 fee is basically negotiable and that the arrival at the $500 fee was basically to keep in line with Queenstown in particular, but other areas in the south, and given also that there is some cost and staff time to actually providing a permit and finding out exactly what's required. I don't have any particular problem with the current $500 fee issue. I wonder whether having a zero fee would actually have the effect of encouraging more filming in Dunedin. And I think that having the same fee over the whole area actually has some advantages. So I'm not convinced that the current $500 fee, which is negotiable anyway, actually needs this kind of change.
Okay. Further speakers? Councillor Gary?
I'm going to support this because I've got a really open mind about this. I want to know more about those advantages and disadvantages. Not to say that I'm going to vote for a zero fee in the long term, but I want to know more. So from that point of view, I'm going to support it.
This is something that I tried to was subject of a resolution about 5 years ago. At the time, the ORC regrettably didn't accept it as an approach. It's something that I think, dating back to the 1980s, Nicola might remind me, there's a joint approach back in the 1990s to the harbour. We've lost that, and I think the frustration that's been expressed by both operators and harbourside dwellers to having to go to two councils to deal with these issues over a number of annual plan cycles leads me to believe that this is the only way that we can get a very sensible plan for how the harbour operates for both the people on and off. So I'm very keen to see it explored further.
Well, subsequent to the conversation yesterday with the West Harbour Community Board, I'm wondering if the mover and seconder would entertain the inclusion of that community board as well, because that's harbour-wide issues, not just...
Yeah, I'm more than happy. I just couldn't remember if it was particularised so much.
Well, they were talking about the Kerry's Bay Slipway and the Aramoana issue, of course.
Yeah.
So,
I'm more than happy with that, yeah. I didn't have my notes with me when I did that submission, sorry.
Well, just for people's information... Sorry, can I, for people's information, I've had for some time since prior to Christmas asked Ms. Graham to talk to the archivists about actually delving out the files around that period in terms of the transfer of ownership, and I've got some of it just now, today, which is the first stage, and I think that will be quite revealing in terms of how such a key asset and name in terms of the port company and what's now Chalmers property came to be wholly owned by the regional council when in fact it lives right in the middle of our city. So I think that's something we would all want to be fully informed about. What then happens is another matter. So as soon as that material sees the light of day, I'll make sure it sees your eyes as well.
I just want to give a bit of context to this. I'd support the inclusion of West Harbour because I think it's a city-wide matter, and those two community boards have been working for some time on this matter. So over the past 5 years, in my previous role, our board has submitted to ORC's annual plan process about managing of the harbour assets. And I have to say some traction has been gained. So one of the things that was... and the submission was around the harbour master, the appointment, which is happening, which is excellent. So OIC has been listening. The other really positive thing is that I've just become aware that DCC has appointed a new staff member in the Parks Department who has a marine knowledge. Now, this staff member has huge credibility already with ORC, and I think that's going to be a really good step forward, positive step forward in terms of that joint approach. So in the last submission that the Otago Peninsula Community Board did to ORC for the annual plan, all of the groups on that peninsula side supported that submission, made their own submissions, everything from Coast Guard to all the different yacht clubs and so forth. And there, as I said, there is some traction that's been gained. I think this time has come for the harbour assets to be acknowledged as having some difficulties in terms of maintenance, expense. And it seems to me that everything from Taroni to all of the boating clubs' facilities, whether they be privately owned or owned by this council, right round to Port Chalmers and beyond, Kerry's Bay, there's quite a momentum coming, and I think it's the age of the facilities that's the issue to some degree. But that difficulty of working with two agencies is very difficult for the public. They don't understand it well. But in any of my dealings with ORC on this in recent years, it's been very positive. So I would support this this motion.
I just had a quick chat to Kate. The term harbour management is potentially bigger than Ben Hur. I would be reluctant for us to get involved in issues of dredging or issues of who can go kite surfing. And I think what we're talking about is harbour edge assets. So if you don't mind, we specifically put that in the resolution. Instead of harbour management, we say harbour edge assets so that we have clarity. I'm meeting my regular catch-up with Peter Bodecker this afternoon, so I can raise this with him there. But I just want to be precise about what it is we want to discuss. And I think that's what you're referring to.
And the Wakawaiata Community Coast, because the Karatani Wharf is also an issue.
It's not a harbour, that's the problem.
Yes, but it's an ORC issue. And again, every time we come up against the high water mark, we are caught between two bodies, and these particular entities are almost always under two authorities. So I think the issue, one of the issues, it doesn't take away from this. It just encompasses the fact that we need to acknowledge that we own everything to the high water mark, and then everything from the high water mark on is in the marine area. So, and it's causing a dropping of the ball. And in addition, you may include, as well as ORC, the Department of Conservation, because that's one of the issues that's coming up with the Aramoana Wharf. So I don't know if I want to make this resolution so large now that it basically is all-encompassing, but I think it's more that this resolution is pointing out something that's really quite relevant, that when you are caught on the boundary of two authorities, often both authorities look away. I do want to see the Wakawaiata Community Coast Board put in there. I probably don't need to see DOC added as on top of the other. Does it matter if it's harbour edges or if it's
coastal edge?
Coastal edge.
Coastal edge assets. Yeah.
And is fine. They're just
I'm more than happy to have it extended, but with all respect, I don't know that Wakawaiata Coast Community Board or even Saddle Hill actually asked for the joint approach, which is actually what this is about.
Karatani Wharf was raised on the Wakawaiata Coast.
Okay, well, yeah.
There's the coastal erosion issue, and like Saddle Hill has a huge amount along there, Brighton, etc. And as well as Wakawaiti, could there be a coastal one and a harbour one?
I think the coastal erosion is a separate issue, and the harbour and coastal edge assets, which this one's about, is probably best dealt with together. Whatever approach we're going to take about wharves is likely to be best if it's consistent across the council. But the coastal erosion issue, there is money in the budget for coastal erosion exploration and for working together on that. It's part of our current joint work with the ORC.
So do we then need to put Saddle Hill in there? Because you've got
The alternative, we can just say community boards, because community boards that have these assets, and then if it ever turns up that something's happening in Brighton, then we've got Saddle Hill covered. So if we just say community boards.
Yeah, I'm more than happy with that.
I'm just wondering if also the DCC has some role, like, in this. I'm not sure.
It's a joint approach between us and the churches.
Ah, okay.
The situation where virtually complete control of the harbour by default was exercised by a commercial organisation whose legal imperative was simply to make money is not acceptable, and it is time that the city took some control of what is arguably one of our greatest assets, not just environmentally, commercially, in terms of visitor potential, in terms of community recreational potential, etc. So this is long overdue, and it won't be acceptable for the ORC to say, well, it's our responsibility, we're going to continue to exercise on our own, because unless there's another mechanism other than the port company, that is simply out of date. Okay, Councillor Vandermas.
We have a much bigger problem in Dunedin than just the harbour and coastal edge. We have the problem that we have an exceptionally large city area all the way to Middlemarch that doesn't just cover the urban city, as in most other cities in New Zealand, but also covers a very substantial part of rural Otago. And then we have a regional council that essentially competes in the same area. The rationale of having a regional council and having a city council, which doesn't even work that well in areas where the urban and rural divide is fairly obvious, works especially poorly for Otago, because we have essentially two competing bureaucracies.
Councillor Vandermas, I appreciate the point you're making, but is it relevant to this issue? And are you taking a stand against this resolution or for it? I'm not sure that it's either.
My stand is for a much more comprehensive version of what's proposed here. What's proposed here is simply looking at an edge issue, which I believe needs to be looked at more globally.
Can you suggest to the mover what you're suggesting you want it to change to?
Yeah. Yes, I would suggest to the mover that what really needs to be looked at here is the whole issue, which is that of having a unitary council.
Not for the purposes of an annual plan submission do I think that, nor did we actually get asked that. This is in response to a submission that was made to us from the community boards, and I'm following that particular one through, which was how do they make it easier to do these things on the water edge. The other issue is, I may well endorse it at many levels, but it's not one I think we can deal with at the annual plan, and that's why I'm not going to accept it. It doesn't mean there's no merit in what you're suggesting.
Is there anywhere where it can be dealt with? Because I've been raising it for 10 years now. Well, I've just been told it's not appropriate for our annual plan. Yeah, and I don't have a problem with the resolution on the wall, other than it only bites a tiny little corner of what is the big issue that we simply won't ever deal with, because it's too big. I'm happy to vote for it. Thank you.
Are there other speakers? Right, there are none. Councillor Wilson? Oh, Councillor Benson.
It's relevant to the wider issues. So there's nothing on the table about that, so I probably can't talk about that. But there is the fact of the matter is that this authority, at the time of local government reorganisation, submitted in favour of a unitary authority much larger than the current Dunedin Media Otago. And that was supported by all the local authorities in the region except for Queenstown Lakes. And so if the councillor with whom I agree on this issue wanted to raise a question for a report for discussion about that, I think people would probably support it. Exactly, which is why I'm asking him to actually do something rather than bleat about it.
Then we can do something after we've dealt with this
one.
That's the process. Right. I'm going to call it. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Abstentions? Carried. Thank you.
To bring it, and it would be, if you're going to bring that kind of issue to the table, it would be well good to have it well prepared, and it may be better at another council meeting. But I'm just so you can raise whatever resolution you wish, and then I'll take advice as to whether it's appropriate to be discussed.
Great, I'll be very happy to know what a best place to bring it up would be, since I've brought it up repeatedly in quite a lot of different forums.
The Chief Executive has some suggestions as to the most productive form of resolution for this. So if we can just let her deal with that in the meantime, and we'll come back to it.
Very happy later for that to happen. Thank you.
All right. Right, so now I'll move on to the other resolutions that Councillor Vanavis.
Oh, just if I've got another one, but I'm happy to get in the queue.
I'll put that on the list. Okay, we'll get to it. Councillor Hawkins, you had one.
Yeah, there's two that I sent through. Apologies. Just while we're queuing up things to consult on 12 months hence, one is on resourcing for the delivery of Council's social housing strategy, and one for, and it's related to, but different to the motion put by Councillor Wilson earlier around options to accelerate delivery of the waste management and minimisation plan and emissions management and reduction plan as part of our bigger conversation during the long-term plan. It's not even 10 o'clock. Just briefly, and punctuation's important because I'm not requesting that the report come back in time for the long-term plan discussions. That needs to come in advance of that. So we want to see how we're going against Council's social housing strategy. I was anticipating that coming late last year, and then subsequently consider options for resourcing it through the long-term plan conversation. This is a growing issue, the provision of social housing in our community, and it's an area with which, sadly, our central government is taking progressively or regressively less interest in. So we need to be having some serious conversations about how we can deliver against our aspirations in that space during the next long-term plan.
I, for one, would be very supportive of this. I think, and I have indicated in some of my recent statements, that I think that one of the challenges looming for Dunedin is housing-related, both in terms of quality of privately owned housing and obviously social housing. And this was identified, the need to look at the provision of social housing into the future was identified when we did our review some 5 years ago, as I recall, and that review indicated that the demand or the need for social housing was going to rise into the future. But I also note that if we want to realise our aspirations of encouraging a more balanced demographic in our city and a different population mix, we're going to have to, and attract people here, then we're going to have the quality and quantity of housing that will keep them here. And I note that there are other councils or council areas adjacent to us which right now are having serious issues around the provision of housing. In Clutha, there's a serious shortage of good quality housing to the point where they're finding it hard to recruit some people into the area. And certainly in central Otago, it's even worse in that lots of businesses, as I understand it, in central Otago simply can't get the staff they need, desperately need, because there's simply no housing for them to live in. So I think rather than wait for a similar problem or a comparable problem to arise in Dunedin, we need to get ahead of it and know what we might need to do, not only to look at the provision of sufficient housing, but look at the quality of the housing. We know we've got the oldest, coldest housing in the country, and that is has implications for people's health, but also in terms of, as I say, encouraging the kind of people we want to attract to the city. So I'm very supportive of this. Councillor Wilson.
Your Worship, I agree with the intent of this, and I'm just mindful, though, that, and I hate to correct you, but I think the social housing strategy was actually done last, leading up to 2010, which means that it's now 7 years old, and it's just making sure that the needs that are in that are still the same needs. And the reason I raise that, and partly because I'm thinking of the co-housing submission that came in earlier in this triennium, and about where they thought we could facilitate not only their project but what the demands might be, and that they're changing, especially now that we're in it. We've got the immigration happening here with the refugees. And so I don't want to limit it just to the strategy. I want it to be also considered in light of the needs of the changing community. And it doesn't necessarily need... Well, I'd like to possibly put under after the comma and current demand or needs.
We can just automatically do that.
Yeah,
if we're going to talk about implementing, it would be very wise for us to explore to update the demand profile. So we'll do that.
Well, I think it will certainly assist in when we get applications like the co-housing, whether that is a demand or not. Thank you.
Put it. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Against? Abstentions? Carried. Thank you.
Now on to the second one, Councillor Hawkins. Is there a seconder for the second resolution? Councillor
Newton. Yeah, just briefly, Your Worship, and this is just picking up on conversations that we had with the solid waste team yesterday afternoon, who are doing noble work in trying to deliver some of our goals around waste minimisation and emissions management and reduction, and therefore reducing the liabilities that we have as a city to pay for those, in some cases through the emissions trading scheme, but also in terms of delivering against our broader commitments, whether it's through the environment strategy or as signatories to the Compact of Mayors or wherever. But dealing with these issues are fairly pressing concerns for us as a city and as a species. So looking forward to seeing some options during the long-term plan discussion as to how we can accelerate the progress that we're making with currently very limited resourcing in this area.
I just want to reiterate, I have a sense of urgency here, in my opinion, with the closing of the Green Island landfill and the future of the resource consent passing in 2023. I don't really think we have much time to wait any longer. I feel that we've waited a long time, so I emphatically support this one as it comes through.
Can I ask the question regarding the assumption that the landfill will close in 2023? Is it a certainty that it will close, or is it quite possible or even probable that we might get an extension of time on that?
At this point, it is unlike. At this point, it looks more likely that it will close. But I'll get a proper report to come back to you on that.
And who would be making that decision?
Well, it would need an extension to the resource consent for it to continue, and then it becomes a question of how much you spend on that and whether we're likely to get it. So we'll come back to council about that.
Get the consent from whom?
The Otago Regional Council.
Ah, there we go again.
I think in addition, Councillor Vanavis, that it's not just the cost of gaining the consent, it's the conditions that you'd have to meet, the raised conditions that you'd have to meet, because it would. I don't think we'd get a consent to continue to operate it under the current conditions. They'd lift up, understandably, and that could cost considerably.
And as we're pointing out that if we were a unitary authority, we would have to imply those conditions on ourselves. So simply becoming a unitary authority doesn't mean we give ourselves a green light to do whatever the hell we want.
Look, I'm going to support this because it just makes sense. The unfortunate lack of wording in our waste management minimisation plan title to resource recovery, and therefore not only actually making money out of what once upon time was waste, which we are doing very effectively in both bottles and cardboard, but the creation of jobs, especially locally, that this can potentially raise, and its answer to some of the demands of the economic development strategy, is why I'm going to support it. It's just a pity it doesn't come out in either the title or the wording of the motion. But there's huge opportunities here, and we really need to go and look at those, and the fact that they tick off so many of our strategies is really, really exciting.
Right, so we're coming back to Councillor Vanavis, to your resolution. Pam has it, I understand. If you could put it up and then I'll ask you to speak to it.
Thank you.
Can I have a seconder for this, please? Councillor Hall. Fine. Councillor Vanavis.
The unitary authority idea has been flagged by government for some years now, not just in the way they treated the regional council in Christchurch or their reasons for wanting Auckland to amalgamate, but the government has for some years created a much easier path for creating a unitary authority, and Dunedin would be the prime sitter for taking up that new path. The reasons are many, but they go back to the creation of the unitary authority in the first place in 1984, when we had a whole lot of very small councils. We had a mayor in St Kilda and lots of little councils all over the place, and to persuade them to become part of the larger Dunedin City Council, a lot of these people needed jobs, and the regional council was essentially created to give them some kind of voice, job, whatever. It was a sop to unification then, and it was a limited unification. We have since had a regional council with a much smaller bureaucracy and a much bigger income stream because of their land in Port Otago gifts that were almost arbitrarily given to them at the time, again, to basically convince people to get on board with the change to the bigger Dunedin view. And since 1984, we have had dual elections. We have had a competing head of the whole Dunedin region in the regional council, and it has not worked well in many, many cases. I can give you examples going back many years when the Mamona Airport extension required a couple of extra toilets. The regional council decided that we had to improve the effluent outflow, which was all fair enough. And we had to spend $150,000 improving what was going into a ditch that cows regularly did their business into anyway. The real issue was that there was $300,000 worth of regional council costs and actually getting that $150,000 worth of work done. We've got a situation where two heads have not been better than one, where in many cases, and we've got had a recent situation with a resource consent in Richardson Street, where we asked the regional council what they wanted in terms of how we were going to apply this resource consent, and they wouldn't tell us. And then when we made a decision and decided that, you know, the foundation had to be 500 millimetres above to avoid flooding, they then came back to us and decided it had to be 800, and now we're in court over that issue. We were in court over and had many, many months of very expensive negotiations over the discharges into the harbour, the 6A issue. And all of these issues have happened because we have essentially two competing bureaucracies trying to run the same Dunedin area, and Dunedin has suffered because of it. The advantages of having a unitary council potentially for Dunedin's development are vast. The issues in getting there are not insignificant, especially since our area basically goes to Middlemarch and regional council obviously goes well beyond that. But they could be well sorted, and a very easy first step would be what the regional council did in Southland, and that was they started by actually getting all the back office functions, the computing systems for Balclutha, Gore and Invercargill, by joining all them together. That already created a whole lot of savings and advantages and economies of scale. So unitary council is the big positive potential for Dunedin City, and it's a positive for the whole region potentially as well. There have even been suggestions that regional councils should combine over the whole of the South Island and only look after regional issues like rivers, etc., in that view. But we really need to look at and get our heads around the value proposition of one council creating a whole heap of efficiencies for all of Dunedin. That's my reason for hoping that we can at least have a serious look at this now. Thank you.
I'm going to support this resolution. I think my support of it is more a case of duplication of authority and activities. If we look at the bus system, the Port of Otago is not under, it's not our council-controlled organisation. And of course, we've just had a resolution on how to deal with what happens when we get to the water's edge. So I think it's a case of efficiencies, of bureaucracy, and making sure that we're all speaking with one voice. I'm not a great supporter, though, of increasing this footprint of the city at all. I think it's big enough as it is, and I wouldn't ever advocate that we'd amalgamate with any other cities. But I do think that for the footprint of the city, I think it would be better if we're all running as a single council. And I certainly know if we just take the buses as an example, things seem to end up in the wrong authority. Thanks.
While I'm likely to support this motion, I have some reservations because I certainly know about the difficulties. I talked about this before with having two councils dealing with the harbour issues of access and assets, just as an example. And the frustrations around that for the community and the confusion in the community about which authority deals with what. However, my concern about this motion is that it possibly will raise or put a wedge between the two authorities at a time when we actually need to work together. So that would be my one reservation going down this path.
I'll be supporting this. You know, it won't solve many of Dunedin's issues, but it really will simplify many, many of the issues that we face around the council table on a regular basis. And to get this report back and to see where the wins are, and there will be losses, but where the wins are and where we can simplify governance in Dunedin, I think would be a great step forward.
Just want to quickly follow up Councillor Garrett's statement, and I agree. This has the potential to cause a relationship of animosity, but I would hope that we can go forward in a spirit of what is good for the city and acknowledge that the ORC has done great things and that they too have I've got the city's interests at heart, and that what we're trying to do here is look for an outcome that's good for the whole of the city, and that we're trying to do this in the spirit of community.
This resolution. I think this is an appropriate time, regardless of whether I think I hadn't come to a conclusion, and indeed that's what this resolution is asking for. It's asking for a report that outlines the advantages and disadvantages so we can make a good call a bit further down the road. But it is an appropriate time. I note that the recent Local Government Amendment Bill focused almost entirely, on the government's preoccupation with rationalising local government in certain areas and certain ways. And it was a result of the frustration that the government and probably a number of other bodies have felt that the mechanisms in place to enable amalgamations around the country have always foundered. They've never worked. There is not a single instance of an amalgamation that has worked through the process that's there through the Local Government Commission. And the most one of the most recent was an attempt to create a unitary authority in the Hawke's Bay, and it failed. And it failed in Northland, and it failed in Wellington. So this is an appropriate time to look at the advantages and disadvantages, but also I note, and I think it's wise to have it in there, the process and that would need to be followed and what the options are or might be in going down this track, because it's certainly not simple, but there is a recognition both at local government New Zealand level and at central government level that some things need to change. There are arrangements, local government arrangements in New Zealand and certain parts of the country that aren't sustainable and will need to change one way or the other anyway. So I think this is an appropriate time to look at that. Councillor Steadman.
I just wonder, it's quite open-ended there. Do we need to put a time in there when the report's to be in by? Because that could be received in 10 years' time, possibly.
No, we'll do it as quickly as we can. So, I mean, it's not a difficult thing at the high level. Maybe not by February, but certainly by the one after that. Reasonably 3 months probably, but possibly quicker than
so
that.
So there's no need to put it in there?
I don't think so. We'll just get this done.
Right.
Councillor Wilson.
It's not something that's healthy to have just hanging around, I don't think.
I'm going to support this motion, although it is merely seeking information. And I think it's the points that the Mayor has made is interesting in light of the previous submission we made about a joint committee. The problem and my frustration is that we try and make alternative arrangements, which in some ways I would like to have added in here, unitary authority or alternative, less formal arrangements to progress the things that we jointly share, but we have failed in the past to be able to do that particularly well. And so the unitary authority becomes the default. So I'm going to agree to learn more about it, but I probably if this is taken up as a threat or anything by the ORC, they really should be reflecting on how their approach to other mechanisms have failed in the past, not just here, but I think in a broader sense. So, I want that context to be part of people's understanding and how it may be reflected in the press and media.
I support the resolution. During the years that I've been on council, there has been plenty of examples where we have not had an efficient outcome or as good an outcome because of the bureaucracy that seems to tie the two organisations fighting each other apart. And I think we need to take a look at what the advantages might be and the disadvantages for this proposal of unitary. A good example recently is the Ross Creek Dam, where we had done all the work for the consenting for that process. The ORC required a different set of advisors. It cost us in the order of $1 million to get that work done, more than the cost of the work that had to be done. So I think there are those sorts of situations indicate that there is something wrong and that there may well be a good opportunity in looking at a unitary authority, assuming we can solve the issue for the rest of Otago. If we're not going to be the only council in Otago, then it's us opting out and wanting to be unitary, and what then do the other councils in Otago do in terms of whether they also support unitaries in their regions?
Yeah, thank you, Your Worship. I'm ambivalent as to the outcome of where this conversation is leading currently, but I'm not going to stand in the way of our staff doing any further thinking about it. Some of my greatest anxieties are around democracy and representation and how such a thing would be structured and where its boundaries would lie. We've said that we want to be a unitary authority, but we don't want to take on the boundaries of what a unitary authority would be. I don't know how that would necessarily work. I also think that there's a note of caution to be made that thinking that restructuring will fix what can be performance or cultural issues, and that we have to be careful about assessing the value of a job existing based on the current performance of people doing those jobs. And finally, I do sense a note of dissatisfaction that may be more deeply rooted in what the function of the regional council is, and that is environmental management. And I don't think that an answer to disagreeing with that function is absorbing the regional council and trying to shut down its role or the role that is necessary for local government to play in the sustainable management of our natural resources. Thanks.
Yeah, I know. I just to the last point that Councillor Elder said.
Yeah, look, I don't know how I feel about this. I suppose I can support it in view of the fact that it is only a high-level look, but it does concern me when I hear people say things like the fighting between the two organisations, because in my opinion the fight sort of has to work when you've got people on both sides doing it, and so that indicates that our own organisation or our own councillors or whatever is not behaving as they should be at all times. So I get a bit nervous about that. Just I certainly have had some very good dealings with the regional council, and I think that the incident that Councillor Staines referred to with the Ross Creek Dam, I'm sure there's plenty of people around the city that would say, I had a problem with the DCC and they demanded this, this and this, and I provided it and then they wanted this. So I just am a bit nervous about this, because it looks like we're the good guys, or we think we're the good guys and they're the bad guys, and I don't think that's the case.
I think some of the services could, I mean, as a pathway to this, be shared a lot more, maybe. I don't know. Services that are dealing with the same area. I don't know. There's a way where we can actually start looking at, like someone said, a computer system that shares both the regional council's concern on the local area and our council, and working closer together. So it doesn't actually have to be a unitary council. Maybe it can be somewhere in between, so that we're not duplicating, that both parties understand one another a lot better and work together a lot better. So, I mean, it doesn't have to be entirely a unitary council, but looking at how ways in which we can work together that helps the city go forward, rather than, like I say, the $1 million, maybe we could have worked a bit together better on the Ross Creek thing. Maybe if we shared, meetings in that area, the environment, etc. So I'm just saying, it can be a partial thing. It can be looking at ways in which we can be more efficient together and talk together better. Thank you.
I'd just like to echo Councillor Lord. I think this has got to be very, very clearly set that it is looking for efficiencies rather than accounting blame. And I see this as a fact-finding mission to see if we can find efficiencies between the two. And I see that as our job for our ratepayers and the citizens of our city, to try and get the best value for their money and obviously deliver them the best service in the best way, and as long as it's presented as that, and rather than, as we say, the good cop versus bad cop, I think I will definitely be supporting it. Thank you.
A divided structure invariably creates divisiveness. I don't think there's any blame to be laid at the feet of the Regional Council or the DCC in terms of the enormous inefficiencies, and there've been a lot of them, such as referred to by Councillor Staines. When you have a divided structure and you have an us and a them situation, there is always going to be divisiveness. The Regional Council, I think it's good that we've acknowledged there has been a combative history with the Regional Council, but I think we also need to acknowledge that that combativeness has actually eased significantly in recent years, that the Regional Council have come closer to our way of thinking and seeing things from our point of view, but more specifically, and coming back to Councillor Hawkins, that we have raised our awareness, especially of environmental management, significantly, to the extent that we are now very much on the same page as the Regional Council. I would also like to acknowledge here that many years ago, I was very keen on us taking over the buses because, quite frankly, the Regional Council weren't doing a very good job of it. Since then, the Regional Council have raised their game significantly. The bus fleet has increased, has improved in a lot of areas, and they now have a whole lot of bus operation expertise, which I think is being more widely acknowledged. So we're now at a point where both councils, I think, have actually come together to some extent and recognised the value that each other had. And I think it's on that basis that we could actually have not just a shared services, as has been suggested, but that we could actually go the step further and send, for instance, out a common rates bill. Just think of the savings, where you get one rates bill that has both the DCC and the ORC rates on it, and you get to pay it all at once. Little things like that would have enormous advantages, but the biggest advantages, I believe, are for anybody wanting to do anything to develop in Dunedin. Currently, the man who wants to build a couple of flats in Richardson Street has gone to the DCC and we've said, you've got to do this, 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 and this to get your consent. And he's done this, 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 and this, and this. Now we're in court with the Regional Council, who actually say, well, no, actually, there's also that. I really feel for the developer. He's wanting to do two lovely little units in Richardson Street where there's an old crappy house now. Richmond Street, sorry, pardon me, thank you for the correction. If we just look at the potential for developing Dunedin in having the strengths of both councils brought together, and I mean brought together, I don't mean one absorbing the other or the bigger one sort of swamping the other. I think that the that by simply no longer having a divided structure, that most of that divisiveness would go. I think that the environmental management side of things is already strongly represented on this council, and that would complement well what the regional council function would be. Council Gehry's concern about the need to work together, I think, is actually best facilitated by changing the structure. The structure is the fundamental problem. The structure is what has created the divisiveness. And a unitary council could, in our case, I believe, work really, really well as it does, for instance, in Nelson. Nelson's a great wee place where they have had for many years now a unitary council. They do their own environmental management. They have lots of really good policies. And I think we should probably get to look at Nelson to see an example of something that has worked well for everybody. So hopefully you will all be able to support at least this initial look. Thank you.
All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Yes.